He already gave a talk last year, which many of you probably remember. Now, with a dozen more things you didn't know about Nextcloud, Joost from Nextcloud, obviously.
This works? Okay, cool. So first of all, I feel rather lonely here on the stage because it's really full. That's a bit odd. I mean, I gave a talk last year and I'm now not sure how much of it I should repeat. So my plan was to talk this time about hopefully things, well, that existing users don't know yet. But at the same time, I'm fairly certain I should also cover a bit of the basics. So I tried to at least add a new angle to that basics element. The first part of my presentation will still be about what's wrong with the cloud. But I'm going to try and put it in a little bit of a bigger perspective than I did last time. And after that, of course, I'll talk a bit about Nextcloud. And in the second half, I get to the stuff that hopefully existing Nextcloud users will find interesting. So again, my goal was to find a couple of things that you didn't know. And well, I'd love to hear afterward if I succeeded at that. I've been asked to try and keep questions until the end, which means remember them. I know personally I never can, so I would write them down. But you know, some people actually have working memory. So in that case, good luck to you. So let's start with the first part. I don't know how many of you saw this article from our friends at the New York Times. They found a cache of data online out of which they could extract the movements of President Donald J. Trump, which I'm sure are kind of supposed to be secret, but you know, the cell tower data is kind of out there and they could track minute by minute pretty much where he was going and where he got his favorite Happy Meal. And this one is also another little news item from a while ago. Google made a security camera, and when people pointed out there was a microphone in it, they said they didn't know that. I still find that fascinating. Maybe they did know, maybe they didn't. But the most important question is, of course, what was it recording? Another interesting news item from some time ago. This is a heat map from a fitness tracker, which kind of accidentally exposed a secret US Army base in Afghanistan, because that's what you're looking at. Yeah. And you know, this was not a bug, this really was a feature. This data was supposed to be online, and you know, you should just turn off your fitness tracker if you're running in a secret army base, which of course didn't happen. This is a bit less funny, I think. So Facebook obviously advertises itself to people who need to advertise to other people, right, to businesses. And in Australia, they advertise their ability to target teenagers when they're at their most vulnerable. The example they gave was, let's say you're a 14-year-old teenager and you go out on your first date coming Saturday. Facebook knows that, of course, because it knows almost everything. And it will know when you're at your most anxious and worried about your date, which is the perfect time to come with an ad about, I don't know, a nice leather jacket. And, you know, of course tell you that it'll arrive on Friday and there you go, we can sell stuff. I think that's pretty nasty. How many of you know Target? It's an American chain, so not the Target thing. Yeah, so they sell all kinds of stuff. Shampoos and, well, stuff for pregnant women. And they had automated targeting algorithms that try to figure out, you know, if one person buys X, then later maybe they will buy Y. And this algorithm on its own kind of figured out that when women buy certain shampoos, they are likely pregnant. because pregnant women have stronger sense of smell, so they will buy less strong smelling shampoos. And if the algorithms would see a change in the behavior of somebody in the shampoos they buy, they will start sending them advertisement for pregnancies. You can imagine that, first of all, sometimes those people didn't even know this themselves, but also their family members who figure out that suddenly they're pregnant without telling anyone, it can lead to some embarrassing conversations. There's a whole lot more, of course, that I can talk about. And I mean, a lot of you follow the news. I'm sure you're quite well aware of what all this data tracking is doing in society. And last time I talked a lot about why privacy is important and, you know, why it matters for us as human beings. People who are being surveilled change their behavior, if they know it, obviously. I think privacy is a human need. It's a very basic human need, and it's wrong to interfere with that. And I mean, the examples go from just a bit scary to just downright criminal. What happened in Myanmar? If you don't know what happened in Myanmar with regards to Facebook, you should Google it or use DuckDuckGo, probably a better search engine. It's truly scary and problematic in so many different ways. Now, I want to, as I said, bring this to a different level as I did last time, because last time I talked about privacy and about personal freedom and how important it is to protect that. But this time I want to look a little bit more at society as a whole. Yeah, what we as a country and bigger companies, but also as a country, what the impact is of, well, essentially these guys and of course many other companies. So I'm going to talk a little bit, economical here, or businessy, which I know this isn't exactly the perfect audience perhaps for this, but in the end, we still live in a capitalist society. I know many of you might not be big fans of that, but it is what feeds us. And there are certain patterns that you see in such systems, in a capitalist system, and one of these I want to talk about here. Now, these companies, they do kind of an interesting thing. If you're a hotel, you have to pay about 25-30% of the money that you get for a hotel room to one of these, if that's the way you sold that room. That's a lot. I mean, that's really a lot, a third almost. I mean, just imagine that you would be making a product and you have to give away a third of what you earn. Well, that's actually what happens on the Apple App Store and the Google App Store too. Now, these percentages are quite okay, I guess, or at least we're used to them in the digital world. But if you know what percentage a supermarket earns on what they sell to you, that's low single digits, way less, a 30% margin on running a website with, well, a fairly small investment relative to the number of visitors. I mean, you can imagine why these companies are making massive amounts of money. But they have another effect too. If hospitals if hotels have less money, they can't invest that money in other things. So what you often see if a company or a society in general has a surplus is extra money, it can do other things. If you go really back in history of mankind, when we were building cities, if you do agriculture, you can produce more than you need per person. So you can have, people who, I don't know, look at the stars, invent stuff, or are priests. Whether that's useful, you can debate. But at least there's a surplus in which you can do something different. And for companies, this often means that they can try new things. Innovate, build new products, make something nice and new. Yeah? And, if these companies are roaming off all the, or taking away all the extra profits from hotels, there will not be a lot of innovation. Now, hotels, what do they innovate? They need to put up new curtains occasionally, and that's probably it, fair enough. I mean, a nice example of this model is, of course, a franchise. And this is kind of what these hotels are becoming. Because in the franchise model, all the innovation happens at the headquarters. Yeah, the people who do the work, the franchise taker, the actual restaurant, they just earn some money, but most of the money is made at headquarters. And that's then used for advertising and for, well, improving the product and making new things. And it's an okay model. I mean, if you decide to be a franchise taker, that's fine. You clearly just want to do something, run a restaurant and not spend too much time trying to think about the menu. That's fine. But the hotel obviously didn't really sign up for that. Now, think beyond this. I mean, okay, hotels, they're important, but our economy here in Europe, especially, doesn't run on hotels. I think you can make quite a strong case, though, that these companies are pretty important for our economy here in Europe. I mean, I know we're all not huge fans of them, mostly because they really are failing to move to electric. But aside from that little snag, they are providing a huge number of jobs, not just at the companies themselves, but other companies that deliver tools to them. Yeah? And a lot of these companies, they are doing pretty innovative stuff. I mean, a modern diesel engine, whether you like it or not, and yes, it sucks for the environment, but it's a pretty marvelous piece of technology. And a lot of that technology isn't just owned and developed by BMW and Audi and the other companies, but it's developed by all the other companies that deliver parts for it. Yeah, I mean, even the pins and the cables and the types of metal and the bougies and, God, I know shit about cars, I'm sorry about that, but those pieces are pretty impressive. And these companies, they innovate because there is enough money going around in that part of the economy. Yeah. But we're all probably very well aware that cars are becoming more digital. So a lot of the interesting stuff is starting to happen in the digital sphere. Yeah, think of self-driving and all the data that's needed for that. Well, where is that data going? Well, it's going where pretty much all our data is going. It's not staying here. Now, I heard today a percentage from someone, which actually then this graph, which I put together myself, so it's completely made up. It's worse than this. That's actually the thing. So apparently only 4% of our data that we generate and have here in Europe is stored in Europe. And that's more than 4% there in the middle. So it should actually be maybe only 2 balls or 3. When I say I made up, I took some percentages and then made it, well, eyeballed the graph. So in that regard, it's made up. So the proportions are actually worse than what this kind of shows. So the data that we need, for the future of our economy here in Europe is there on the left and to some degree in the right. It's not where we need it to be. So if we don't want to all become a franchise here in Europe, we need to take back control over that data. That was it. I hope that brings the subject to a different level than usual. Thank you. So now let's get to the next loud part. I don't know if the screenshot is very readable, but Nextcloud purports to be a safe home for all your data. It's a self-hosted, open source, content collaboration platform. Content, your stuff, files, documents, calendars, notes, contact data, metadata, comments, etc. Collaboration, you can share documents, you can work together on documents, you can have a video call with somebody else, you can have a chat with somebody else, all on your own server. It's a platform, which means there are a lot of apps, a lot of extra functionality that you can add to Nextcloud. Now, the last year, I gave a talk here with the subject, I think 200 things you can do with Nextcloud. Well, first of all, there's obviously a lot more you can do. At the same time, well, there aren't 200 different apps that I went through that time. I'm not really going to try to complete that, but the idea there was, of course, there are more than 200 apps developed for Nextcloud that add all kinds of things, and Well, that was the point I was trying to get across. And my idea this time was that I'll essentially pick up where I left off and go over a bunch of other things that you can do with it. But let me first continue and get a bit of an overview of this Nextcloud thing. So this is a normal web interface that you're, well, confronted with when you use it. You have your files in the middle. On top you see, yeah. We try to be smart. I don't want to call it machine learning because it's bloody statistics, but it shows, you know, files that have been recently edited, recently shared with you, or otherwise, yeah, somebody commented on a file. They get put on top. Hopefully they're the files that you're interested in at this point in time. On the right, the sidebar, you can share files and see who you shared the file with. You also have activity here, which essentially shows a history of things that happened to the file. And you can comment on the file. And there's some more stuff that I'll get to later. And on the left, you have a navigation bar, essentially different ways of getting at your files. You also have a picture viewer, gallery application, that does the same thing as the file view, except it focuses more on pictures. We have a lot of security stuff, because when you put your whole life somewhere, you should feel secure, and it should be secure, and protect your data. So there's a whole host of two-factor authentication things, and other security stuff. I'll get to a few security things, but I don't think I will repeat too much of that. We have notifications that, well, come in on your desktop, but also on your mobile phone, because of course there are mobile apps for Nextcloud as well. This is kind of a timeline of everything that happened to your files. I'll throw a few slides with words at you. Sorry for those more visually oriented people. I put icons on the bottom for you. One of the main, most important things, I think, that set Nextcloud apart from many other attempts at trying to build something similar is that it's easy to use. At least we try to keep it easy to use. And I mean, a lot of people here are techies, but even most technical people appreciate when a user interface is designed to try and get out of your way. Now, of course, it's really hard to do that perfectly, but we do our best, and I think we've done a pretty decent job trying to keep Nextcloud as easy to use for an end user, but also for the system administrator. It's pretty important for us to keep Nextcloud really easy to deploy. So we use the LAMP stack. With all its pros and cons, it's a system that's relatively easy to deploy. PHP, we're on Linux with Apache and MySQL. We even rewritten a couple of applications from other languages into PHP. Which again, perhaps if you're a language purist, you say, why would you write from Go to PHP? But the thing is, now you can install it with one click. It scales the same way the rest of Nextcloud scales. Yeah, and Nextcloud scales impressively well. Our largest deployment has about 20 million users. And that's a single deployment. So there's one page you go to, you log in. Obviously, your data is not on one server, because that does not scale. It's a cluster. It's more like a cluster of clusters, actually. It's called a global scale infrastructure. But again, in terms of scalability, yes, it works on a Raspberry Pi. And yes, it works on, well, we call it global scale for a reason. Yeah, we think it, I don't know, maybe it's a bit arrogant to say it can scale to 7 billion users, but I'd like to think it can. Well, all platform access, there come the icons, of course. I mean, Linux, Windows, Mac, and Android, iOS. But there are also some people who develop and maintain apps. Well, there was somebody maintaining an app for Windows Mobile. I don't know if that's still very relevant. There is one of our developers at least now working on a Talk app for Yola. So Yola fans, there you go. There is some work happening there too. More bullet points, no pictures. I'm sorry. It's another important point for Nextcloud is that it should fit in your infrastructure. So especially as a private user, of course, you run it on one computer, most likely, or a lot of people run it on old laptop or a Raspberry Pi, as I said. But if you're a company, you want to connect it to your user directory in LDAP, you want to, you know, connect it to your NFS file storage or even your SharePoint, if you really want to do that to yourself, And that's all possible. Yeah, Nextcloud can get the files wherever they are, and you're not limited to one of those. For example, Renater, that's the, what's it called? French university organization, not one university, like a collective of all the universities in France. They're kind of represented and supported by one organization. That organization is called Renater. And they are setting up a Nextcloud instance for everyone, all the universities. At least they can use it. They don't have to, of course. And what they wanted to do is that every university can manage their own users. Now, ideally, of course, not via a separate user database, but they should all just be able to connect their own LDAP to Nextcloud. But that would, of course, be thousands, tens of thousands of LDAP connections to a single Nextcloud instance. Well, that's the plan, and that's what we're doing at the moment. So it can scale pretty well also in that regard if you want to. Fancy features, well, encryption, there's a whole bunch of those. I can go into details at some point, but that might be better for at the boat. And versioning, sharing with public links, passwords, the whole thing that you expect if you want to work with other people together on the internet. Nice feature, server-to-server sharing. So if you're on one Nextcloud, other users on another Nextcloud, they can share a file from one user on one Nextcloud to the other user on another Nextcloud. Yeah, and the Nextclouds will then exchange the file the moment it is requested, but the file stays on the original Nextcloud because we want that original user whose data it is to stay in control. Yeah, so the data is then not cached by the other one, it's just delivered whenever the user requests it. A lot of Nextcloud apps, I mentioned it already. Security, can talk a lot about this, let's just skip to the last point. If you find a security issue in Nextcloud, 10K is yours. Go nuts. It's completely open source. Yeah, the whole thing, top to bottom. You have a lot of users, tens of millions. I mean, we know of one really big installation of 20 million. There are about 300,000 different Nextcloud servers on the internet. That's an estimate, because we don't track them. Not unsurprisingly, but it's a pretty decent estimate, I think. It's somewhere between 250K. I mean, you can see how many downloads there are of some apps, and I know, for example, the calendar app has about, what was it, 180,000 downloads for one version. So unless people repeatedly downloaded the same version, which, well, you can't really do. Well, you could, but why would you? I think that gives a pretty good idea of just one app. And of course, that's not used by everyone. Yeah? That's just an app you could install if you want to. A lot of contributors we have. There's also a company behind Nextcloud. I work at the company. There are about 40 people at the moment. And our business is completely focused on helping organizations like Renater or the German federal government or the French Ministry of Interior or Siemens or, you know, other small and big companies run Nextcloud. So essentially it's a Red Hat model, they pay for services. We use part of that money obviously to provide them support and part of it to make Nextcloud better, hopefully for everyone. People, we do a conference in Berlin every year. We haven't announced the dates yet, but it's gonna be most likely in September this year again. Some of our customers, favorite or not, and an old picture of the team. I skip through this and I'll get to the fun part. And of course, Nextcloud is not the only project that does cool stuff. Lots of others do too. I always like to show some friends. Nextcloud.com/, you know, you think of it. So that's Nextcloud. Okay. If there are questions, write them down. Let's get to the fun part. So my colleague Arthur has already been talking here today about Nextcloud Flow, which is a new feature that's coming in Nextcloud 18 in 3 weeks, approximately. And it was pretty cool. I found it fun that at some point people asked him too many questions, I guess, about it, and he said, you know, you better ask Jos about it, because he can talk better about Nextcloud Flow. And just to be clear, because I was then asked, you know more about it? No, obviously not. I just talk. He knows more about it. I just talk more about it. that was the right characterization. So the idea of flow is there are certain triggers in Nextcloud which can be provided by apps, any app. And then there are certain actions that can also be provided by apps. And the user can connect these. So I say user, the admin can do it, but also the end users can. And an action can be post something in a chat message, do a notification, run this through a script, send an email, create a task in a calendar, things like that. Or even hit an endpoint on another server, or send some XML somewhere. It can be anything. And the trigger can be, well, an obvious thing is files. So file is put in a certain folder with a certain tag at a certain time by a certain person in a certain group. But it can also be an alarm for your calendar, or somebody said something in a chat, or again, an endpoint on Nextcloud got triggered by an external something. Now, so in theory, once this is done and has more of the knobs and buttons to play with, yes, you could use Nextcloud to run your home automation. No more Google stuff for that. However, again, that's not done yet. But this is done, and this works. So I already have like a nice video, maybe Arthur already showed it for those of you who were here, where you put a file in a folder, and then you get a text in a notification in a chat, and one of the chat rooms that says, hey, you know, this file was put into that folder. I personally think that's already pretty nice. And the PDF converter, I mean, the most obvious thing with the PDF converters, of course, you know, if you assign a tag, convert to PDF, then it becomes a PDF. But you can, of course, do much fancier stuff there, saying like, hey, you know, files put in this folder by somebody from that group, turn them into a PDF, and then maybe create another flow that then emails that PDF to somebody, etc. Now, these are the kind of things we're looking for. That's my dog. And I think the point here was to show there's now a sidebar in the picture viewer app. And of course, an opportunity to show my dog. She's very cute. So this is also a nice work in progress. In the sidebar, you have a chat, if you have Nextcloud Talk installed, that is. So you can ping people and, you know, have a conversation with them right there on the file, on the spot. And this kind of integration is, of course, very nice, especially when you're editing a document with somebody else. Then it's really nice to have a video call or a chat. Calls are coming, as it says, this is a test version, so the calls don't work yet. But if you're editing a document with someone else, it's nice to be able to talk, of course, to the other person you're working with. And all of this works on mobile, eh? So this works on your phone, although they have a kind of tiny screen, of course, and certainly on like a tablet, an iPad or something. Well, there's the phone screenshot with a not working shadow. That's great. Another nice feature is that you can actually share a file directly to a chat session. Yeah, so I'm typing here the name of a chat. You see that the autocomplete, which goes to the top because of the screen resolution, autocompletes the name of the chat session. So the file then comes in there. And that works on your phone too, because here on the phone, I am actually selecting the files to share in a chat. This is not our file app, but our talk app. Other things in the sidebar is a projects thing. So projects are a feature that we introduced earlier this year. And what it allows you to do is to connect objects, things. So it's hard to define what you're talking about when you can have chats and deck cards and calendar items and mails and files. Things, you can connect them with each other across apps. So for example, you can connect this file to another file, or you can connect it to a chat, or indeed to a deck task, or to a chat here. And this is an example. Yeah, Project Starfish on the right has connected to it a file, another file, a folder, another file. Not very creative. And the chat. Let me see if I have something better. So this is a card in deck. Deck is a Kanban app. So you have stacks of cards to do, in progress, done, and you put the cards between them. And one of these cards here or I think actually the whole deck, is connected to this project as well. So there are two other of those connected to it, as well as the chat and the files. Now what happens if you share a file that's part of a project? Well, the file gets shared, but a project too, but only the things that are shared. So if you share half of these files with someone else, they have access to those files and can see that they're part of this project Starfish, but they can't see the other files. So they are still your private files connected to Project Starfish. And that way, if you click them, you go directly to the file. So you keep this connection between different places, different apps, and the thing that you're working on. I'm going back to talk again. There was something I wanted to show. It's kind of nice, and I really hope more people are going to build these things. God, I completely forgot the name of them. Commands, very creative. So yeah, you can run commands, which is essentially, you know, you do slash and you call one of the different commands and you give it parameters. I don't know, the Hacker News one and the Wikimedia one are pretty obvious, I guess, but we're hoping people will build other ones. Yeah, this is of course a bit similar to what Slack has, which is something we try to compete with, because, you know, on-premise. Another thing that's relatively new, ACLs. So, again, normal home users usually don't need this stuff, but companies are still very much stuck in the 90s, I'd like to say, or maybe it's a bit nicer to say they work differently. A lot of companies, they have like a couple of folders they need to share with everyone in the company, and then they like to control the access to parts of that folder between different groups. So for example, you have one folder structure in the company that is shared with everyone, but there's a subfolder in there for the finance department where only the finance department can edit files and only management and finance can see them and nobody else can get into that folder. Now for this, you have ACLs. And for Nextcloud, we didn't want to add ACLs to the normal files because we have a different way of sharing. If someone needs access to it, you share it with them. Yeah, not one big directory structure and all that stuff. We work with a flat sharing model. So we have group folders, which kind of brings this hierarchical sharing to Nextcloud. And with a group folder, you can create one or multiple of these company-wide, organization-wide shares, share them to groups or the whole company or subgroups. And then in there, you have ACLs. So per subfolder then, or per file, you can give access rights and take them away. And you can also let sub-administrators manage this. So you have in Nextcloud the concept of group administrator, somebody who can administrator a group of users. And this group administrator can then also administer the access rights via the ACLs in the group folder. Another nice feature. I mean, it's old, but I think, I don't know, a lot of people might not know it. You can create guest users in Nextcloud. You just type a name, and if it's not a known user and you have the guest account app installed, it will pop up this account when you click create guest account. You give a name and an email address. You click on save and share. Then the account is created. The person whose email address you entered gets an email and say, hey, you know, you got a new account on Nextcloud, please log in, set up your password and maybe your two-factor authentication, and the file is shared with them and they have access to it. So guest users have a number of limitations. Essentially, they can't really upload their own files. They have zero storage space. But of course, if you share a folder with them where they have write rights, then they can upload files in that folder, as is obvious. And as an admin, you can then whitelist applications that they have access to, so you can give them access to talk, to the calendar, to contacts, to mail, to pretty much any of the apps, if you like, including, of course, the collaborative document editing, etc., which is nice. Other new thing, you know, we have a lobby in Talk. So if you share, you know, a talk room with someone or a number of people with public link, you can enable the lobby feature, and then the people who join the link will stay in this not very pretty screen until the time runs out and the room starts, or one of the admins in the room says, let's start, and then they join. I was looking for another opportunity to put in the dog, and I found one. There's also a nice feature. So you see I've set a password here, and there's a button below it which is called Password Protect by Talk. The fancy marketing term that we use for that is video verification, because it alliterates. And what this does is it allows you to verify the identity of the recipient of the share before you give them access. So think you're a doctor, you're sharing the results of a test with your patient. You want to make sure, of course, only the patient gets it. Now, you can do the traditional stuff. You send them a public link. You send them, if you're smart, over another channel, the password. But you know, the kid or a spouse might have access to the phone from that person. So while you have quite some guarantees, it's not really waterproof. And if it's really sensitive information, you might want to be 100% sure and not 95. Now, that's what this does. Because a recipient, as usual, gets a screen that says enter the password, but you don't send the password. You keep the password, and they have to click request. And at that point, a video call starts, and your phone will ring, or your Nextcloud interface will ping you, and you have to have a video call, and then you give them permission to access the files. So you know who it is, 100% sure. No chance it's someone else. Well, if you know them. Nice. Next time you need to set up a Nextcloud account on a mobile app, check this out. You go to your security settings as a user. You click add password at the bottom, and you show the QR code. You just scan the code from the login screen on the app. There's a button right there with a QR code icon. You click it, you immediately get the camera, you zap, and you're completely set up and it's syncing right away. Saves a lot of typing long passwords and second factor authentication and all that stuff. Quite nice. Ah, we managed to hit a buzzword bingo. Because we actually use a little bit of real machine learning in Nextcloud, if you have this app enabled. And what it does is it trains a neural network on your logins. And then it warns you when it sees a unfamiliar, weird login location. Yeah, if you always log in at 9 o'clock at the office every day, 5 days a week, and suddenly in the early afternoon there's a login from Shanghai, assuming that your office isn't in Shanghai, you will get a warning. And then, of course, you can kill the session or change your password, etc. Quite nice. It takes, of course, a little while to train the data, 60 days, I think. After that, it will start warning you. And it's pretty accurate, at least for me. I rarely get warnings. And when I do, it's really because I'm traveling or something. So it can also mean that nobody tries to hack me, which is good. So this is the list of your sessions, by the way. And if you then see that there's a suspicious login, you can, well, revoke the keys of that session and essentially shut it down. If it's not a device, you can also wipe it. So we now have the ability to wipe like your mobile phone or your desktop client remotely from Nextcloud. Administrator can do this too, but administrator can only wipe all devices from a specific user. So not per device, but as user you can say only wipe my phone, only wipe my desktop client, etc. Now, I'm into security stuff now anyway. So we have watermarks, which is nice because, of course, you can configure it that the guest users always see watermarks or something like that. Keep your stuff under control. That setting up TOTP, I guess I run out of ideas at this point. So we can do two things. I have a few more screenshots, but we could also get to questions. I think that it's a good idea to get to questions by now. before everybody gets bored. Yeah, questions. Please stick a hand in the air, arm in the air, and then you will.
Question round. There's me, the Herald, and the Signal Angel. So two people with microphones. Just raise your hand when you have a question, and we will come to you.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you. I want to ask, I'm hosting a Nextcloud instance since 2 years. And
sorry.
I'm hosting a Nextcloud since 2 years. And I want to connect it with my local NAS. Is this possible? So I'm hosting it on my own server on the web. Mm-hmm. And I want to connect it with my local storage. Is this possible?
Yeah, that should be possible. So that's what external storage is for. At least if you want to use your NAS just for the storage and you have your Nextcloud, well, also at home, that's probably the most performant solution. But even if you have your Nextcloud in a data center or something, it is possible to add your local NAS as an external storage, depending on what connection you can make. Like it supports Samba, it supports NFS. Those are probably the best options. Web dev is also possible. Go to the setting, look for the external storage app, enable it, go to the settings, add an external storage. It's reasonably, well, I don't want to say obvious, but, you know, you should figure it out together with the docs. Yeah.
Then we have a question over there, please.
Yeah.
Thanks for the talk. It was really great. I'm using Nextcloud myself on my own server for a long time. I use it for everything. But one thing bugs me, because if you want to simply upload a lot of files to Nextcloud with the default files app, mm-hmm. Nothing like WebDAV or the sync client, and one file upload times out or something, you cannot repeat it because you don't have a list of the dedicated files that are getting uploaded right now. So are there any plans to have like a list, like in the Android app, of the files currently being uploaded? Because if you have a lot of files and you don't use an app like Flow Upload, it can really get a problem.
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's a bit of a workaround, but what you could try, I actually use it myself sometimes. You have the ability to use create a public upload link with file drop feature. So you probably know it, but for the benefit of other people, I will explain. Like when you create a folder and you make a share link out of it, and you allow writing to the folder, that means people can upload files in it. Then you have an extra feature that essentially lets you hide the current content of that folder. So the recipient of the link just gets a screen with your avatar in the middle, and please drop files here. And this shows you the files that are being uploaded and have been uploaded, I believe. That might do what you want. It's worth a try. But otherwise, I mean, honestly, I think this is exactly what an app like Flow Upload is supposed to do. I think it's fine to just use it for that. Yeah, I mean, making things more complicated for a case that's pretty rare is, I think, well, that's better to be done in an app. So I would stick with that.
Okay.
Next.
If you have more questions, still raise your hand. We will get the microphone to you right now.
There's. Okay.
Can you tell us more about the advantages or disadvantages of setting up a home server with Nextcloud or renting some web space instead of performance and security?
Yeah. Yeah. I run Nextcloud on an old desktop at home. Yeah. I like it that way because I literally know where my server is and where my data is. Plus, it's a good use of my old hardware, and, you know. I mean, yeah, in terms of performance, if you rent a server at something like Hetzner, it's probably faster. I mean, obviously, their upload pipe to the internet is slightly bigger than what I get from Kabel Deutschland. So, on the other hand, for me, it's good enough. I mean, honestly, the upload is usually the limitation, right, at home. I mean, the speed of the server is not a problem. I mean, it's for me, it's just an old Intel desktop, so it's more than fast enough. It's really the upload speed, and I have, like, what is it, 6 or 8 megabit up. So when you're remote and you're, like, I don't know, browsing images, it's fine. If you're remote and you want to download files right here from a private server, it's also, it's not that bad, 1 megabyte a second, you know? That's okay. And, you know, when I'm traveling and at night I put my phone on the charger so that it uploads all my pictures to home, well, that goes really fast, because then the 100 megabit download at home is actually perfect. So, for me, it's not a bottleneck. Of course, if you're on a tiny upload, then, yeah, then it's not nice, yeah, because that's going to be the bottleneck, I think, mostly. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi.
Oh.
Hello.
Yeah.
So Nextcloud is really great, but I was wondering, have you ever thought about integrating it with GitLab to your lab?
Integrating with GitLab. Sorry, I don't see. Wave at me.
A little more to the left.
Ah, jeez. Yeah. Sorry. Further to the left. Okay. Integrating with GitLab. So, do you mean mostly for the Git part of it?
Yes, yeah. So that Git is GitLab is used for
you would use GitLab storage or something.
And yes, but Nextcloud for file storage, for example. Nextcloud for file storage.
And GitLab then for, because I
for
mean,
version control.
Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah. Well, the thing is, I actually had a really long Twitter discussion with somebody about that recently. Yeah, I know Twitter. Don't get me started. The thing is that Git is really not nice for general files. It's for source code. And Nextcloud isn't very good at source code. Right? You're doing two very different things. For one, Git will merge changes. In other words, it screws around with your files, which, as long as it's source code, you're happy with because you want to merge the changes. But when it's, I don't know, Photoshop files, aside from the fact that it will simply not do that anyway, like, in that use case, you don't want it to do that.
Yes, yeah? But in the use case that you have some large files and you have some code that works with these files, you want to have, for example, files on Nextcloud, but code on GitLab.
Ah, so okay, so nice you mean to separate the two a little
bit. Yeah, separate the two, yeah. So make them work together, for example, with same users or something like that.
So, yeah, I guess that could make sense to some degree, but I think there's a lot of disconnect between the way you use the two that would create issues. I'd rather not go into it here. It's rather, you know, workflow specific, but...
And that's fair, because we also don't have a lot of time left. We have one last question over here.
All right.
Yeah. Yours, a question. There's the brute force protection built in.
Yes.
As a Nextcloud admin, I have now and then the problem that I have to go on the server to clean up the database for locked IPs. I really wish to have an admin... setting to clean up blocked
IPs.
Logins, yeah?
Okay. Yeah, is there a feature request already? I mean, create one if not. That's fair enough. Okay, I think that's it.
With this, I would like to have a warm round of applause for yours.
Thank you.